Here's the deal. NASA is building its own new rocket called SLS for more than 10 years now. It is a part of the Artemis program designed to bring people back to the moon, and it is supposed to hit its maiden flight really soon. But there is a huge problem with that. It turns out to be extremely expensive. The latest figures suggest that it can cost as much as $4.1 billion for each single flight. And that doesn't even count the $20 billion already spent on its development. That's an absurd amount of money. At the same time, the competition is getting dangerously close. So doesn't it mean that SLS is just a huge failure? Well, let's figure this out. The first question you might be asking is, why does NASA even need a rocket like the SLS? You see, NASA's program to return to the moon was settled a while ago. And to get there, you need to have a rocket and a spacecraft that will be capable of doing so. As a result, the Orion capsule was developed and built, which needs a heavy rocket to deliver it to the moon. In addition to that, NASA had to work with its existing contractors because of political reasons. And that is why SLS did inherit a lot of its technology from previous projects. The most obvious being the RS-25 engines made by Aerojet Rocketdyne. These are literally the same engines that were used in the space shuttle program. 14 of them actually flew to space on previous missions, and after some minor adjustments, they are integrated into the SLS. And if each shuttle had 3 of them, the new rocket is running 4. The boosters that are attached on the side are also sort of inherited from the space shuttle program. They are updated, improved, and made more powerful, but conceptually, they are very similar. So all this means that currently, SLS is a very powerful, very capable rocket that literally is based on last century's tech from the 80s, when the space shuttle program was initially developed. It is a new rocket that isn't even designed with reusability in mind. For a long time, they said that it would be the only rocket capable enough to launch the Orion capsule to the moon's orbit. Even Falcon Heavy, the most powerful rocket which flies to date, couldn't do that even in a fully expandable mode. But at the same time, you have to consider that its launch costs like 20 times less. So now that situation is rapidly changing. Of course, the main disruptor here is SpaceX with their Starship, but Blue Origin, ULA and others are also closing in on NASA. All their projects will be considerably cheaper than what SLS has to offer, both in terms of development and final launch costs. And also, all of them should be able to launch much more often than once a year, and that is considered to be the upper limit of the SLS. For example, Elon Musk previously said that the entire development of Starship could cost around $5 billion, which is only 25% bigger than a single SLS launch, not taking the massive development cost into account. And after that, if Starship will really be the fully reusable rocket it promises to be, each launch cost could be literally 100 times less than the SLS or even more. Of course, you need to take everything Elon says with a grain of salt, but still, Starship looks very, very promising. So at the moment, SLS looks like a rocket whose entire existence is only sustained by politicians and lobbyists who are allowing the existing contractors like Boeing and Lockheed Martin having their way, making sure there is a huge money flow, and that they can take all the time they want to deliver results. SLS also has a very specific purpose. It is supposed to put an Orion capsule into the moon orbit. That's it. At the moment, it is the one job that this rocket is built for. So if somebody will be capable of doing the same thing, but for a fraction of the cost, will it make the SLS obsolete? Will it mean that all this money and effort was for nothing and NASA failed miserably with this project? Well, not exactly. Firstly, SLS can theoretically become a bit more reusable and cost-effective. However, I wouldn't put my money on that. Secondly, SLS will still be one of the most capable rockets out there in the nearest future. Block 2 configuration should be able to deliver 130 tons to LEO, which technically is more than 100 tons that Starship claims. However, this might not be a fair comparison, as you need to consider rapid reusability, orbital refueling, and things like that. But I think that the main point why NASA built the SLS is because it's a government agency. And it is not exactly correct to directly compare them to likes of SpaceX, Blue Origin, ULA and others. The first priority of NASA should be reliability and minimizing risks when it comes to delivering the results of the program, so it simply cannot take risky paths, even if it wanted to. You should also remember that Starship looks great at the moment, but there are still multiple obstacles it can face, like orbital refueling, landing landing procedures, the reliability of the heat shield, rupture production rate, etc. And there are absolutely no guarantees that any of them won't become a serious problem at some point that will take a lot of time to solve. And if something goes wrong, for a private company, worst case scenario, it doesn't deliver on its contracts and goes bankrupt. Whereas NASA just cannot afford risk like that being a government agency. Another thing you need to consider is that SLS program was started over 10 years ago. At that time, SpaceX were only starting to launch their first Falcon 9s. All the landings of the first stages, all the talks about reflying them and reusing other parts like the fairings were hardly considered serious at that time. And of course, nobody could predict a rapid development of Starship back then. So that is exactly the reason NASA is currently changing the way it works, to adapt to the realities of the new world we're living in. Instead of developing its own tech and owning it, NASA now tries to help private companies develop their own technology and buy their services. This is how the human landing program will be done, this is how the lunar gateway will be done, how the new space stations will be built, etc. It seems like a more sustainable model that allows NASA to cut its costs and at the same time stimulate competition. But SLS is more like a hardcore backup plan, a safe option that NASA put a bet on the beginning of the Artemis program. Yes, it is crazy expensive and it is really easy to hate at the moment, but that is only because of the success of one company, which is SpaceX. And technically, they don't even have a rival to SLS yet, because Starship is still in the development phase. And just imagine if something went wrong with SpaceX during these 10 years. So even considering the fact that Space Launch System is indeed a massively expensive rocket that has very limited applications, I believe that it is the necessary evil. If there was no SLS and NASA did rely solely on private companies to get to the moon, the risks would be too high. Remember when they had to fly to the ISS on Russian rockets for almost a decade, when the space shuttle was already decommissioned and the commercial crew program was still in development? That left NASA really vulnerable and dependent. And if you look at the situation like this, then paying $20 billion for development and another $4 billion per launch doesn't look that high of a price to avoid situations like that. Especially when we know what Russia is capable of doing and how fragile any political alliances can be. So if you consider all that, if you take all that into account, SLS doesn't look that awful anymore. Of course, we can all occasionally poke NASA for using last-century technology and massively overspending, but SLS is a safe option that had to be there. And just imagine if we lived in a timeline where Starship wouldn't be at the point it is right now. Nobody would even question SLS. So what do you think? Did NASA make the right call for sticking to the SLS? Or maybe they should have adopted the commercial approach earlier? Let me know in the comment section below. Also, don't forget to thumbs up this video if you liked it, or dislike if you didn't. Subscribe for more videos like that, but most importantly, stay curious, my friends.